is very exciting for me, simply because it's something that I really like talking about. So it feels like second nature to be here and to have the platform again to talk to all of you about something that has really changed my life over the last maybe about 4 years. And I mean, it hasn't been a very long time. So I think that's what's really interesting also for me to share with you. And I want to be able to kind of take you through that journey of a bit of a light bulb moment and how that has changed my life and my thinking, and also my home and those around me in my community. So if I can start off, Natasha's going to help me with the slides today, because I'm taking this this session on my phone. So I know that Natasha is going to have to do some of the work. So you're going to have to bear with both of us as we run through this. Okay, so I know this term conscious consumerism at the very outset looks really like intimidating and scary. And like, you know, it's a lot of, I mean, in some sense, I think it feels like in terms of terminology, something, you know, really big. But what we're trying to say, I mean, quite simplistically, is to be conscious about how you consume, right? What you buy, what you do, where you go, how you travel, what you eat. It's just a whole bunch of things. And I'll just show you how we've been managing this in the last few years. And I must also say that there's no kind of perfect, you know, I know that online you find YouTubers who talk about being zero waste, right? Which I think is an incredibly interesting concept. But I mean, my home, and I think a lot of those of us who are aspiring to be conscious, we find it very hard to be 100% zero plastic. And so, you know, I think there's also this idea that if you're not zero plastic, there's kind of no point in doing these little things, right? And I think I want to be able to challenge that and tell you there are over 100 things you can do in your own homes to change the narrative and to change how you deal and kind of, you know, work with the world and navigate through all of these things. So the next slide is just, I want to be able to say how it started. So in the background of that picture, and I don't know how clear this is for you, especially those of you who might be viewing this on a mobile phone, is a picture of Mi Tottamulla. Now, to those of you who might be on the younger end of the spectrum with us today, I know that there's a kind of a older, younger spectrum. So for those of you on the younger end of the spectrum, maybe you don't have a massive recollection of this, but it happened in 2017, the Mi Tottamulla garbage dump collapse. Which happened on Aurudu Day. And I think for me, that was the first time in my entire adult life I had started like thinking of what garbage meant. Because up until that day, specifically that day, I didn't care. I mean, garbage existed. I could write things about how it was important to the environment. I could talk about like being environmentally friendly or whatever that meant, right? But for me, on a personal level, I had never really engaged with anything. I have just been, I mean, it was kind of, now that I think about it, a little vacuous. It was always, you know, about a Facebook post or whatever. And beyond that, I had never really engaged. When I was 11, when I was in school, that was the first time Dr. Ajanta Pereira, I distinctly remember her coming to the school auditorium for assembly on a Monday morning, which is the day that we all come together. And she did this presentation on recycling, pratichakrikarane. Like that was the first time in my entire life I had heard the word, and I later found out that she had been a part of coining that word in Sinhala. And so Dr. Ajanta said, Mama Kunu Regina, right? I was the garbage queen. And she talked about garbage and about composting and about recycling. And it was so interesting. But up until the Mi Tottamulla garbage dump collapse, I was just so distant from this concept of recycling. Like it never occurred to me that it should be something that I should be conscious of. Sorry, I'm just going to move a bit just to make sure that my phone stays charged and doesn't die out on me and all of us. And as a result of this, it became like, it was just so, for me, I was so moved by this because I had, again, I think it was 32 people who passed away on Aurudu. And I thought to myself, for the first time in my life, I thought, you know, my gosh, like, am I am I a part of this? Am I a part of a system? Or what is my contribution? Or what was my contribution to that garbage dump? And it wasn't until a little later on that I actually realized that my garbage wasn't even going to Meepakkamulla. My garbage was in fact going to Boralasgamuwa, right? But I didn't even know that because I was just so, you know, it was just literally if the kunu lorry didn't come at least once a week, I would have a mini, like little mountain outside our house of black garbage bags that would often rot and smell, and it was horrible. And that's how I've lived, and I never questioned it. So it was Meepakkamulla that questioned it. So I wanted to share the backstory with you also, because I think different kind of socio-political, economic changes can affect us. And so this definitely affected us. So after this happened, I decided, okay, I need to do something. How do I change this in my own home, right? If it was my garbage, and I remember again, I've been saying this quite a lot of these kind of speaking engagements. I remember this thing that was a Facebook post in Sinhala that said, "Obage toffee kolaya unat e kunukhanda ekathu wenna athi." Right. And I thought to myself, my gosh, so like, you know, I was a part of it. Right. So then it became a very reflective time for me when I was trying to figure out how do I change my own habits? Because up until then, we had one dustbin. There was no segregation of waste. We had, I had one child by then. I now have two. So we were using a lot of diapers. There was a lot of, it was like, I suppose in some sense, a very middle class, unconscious, it was unconscious in many ways, life of how we dealt with the world around us, right? Like it was just like the world exists, I exist, so who cares? Very selfish life I lived. Not saying I'm selfless now, but a little more conscious, right? So that's what I want to talk to you guys about how that whole change happened. So the first thing I did was I wanted to see how I can minimize bringing polythene. That was an easy thing. Like that's one of the first things you know that you can change. And then I realized I wanted to, I was shopping at supermarkets, but I didn't have bags, produce bags that I could bring stuff back in. And so if I can move to the next slide. And so the next thing I did was to create these bags, Cali reusable bags, which was a venture. It took me about a year because I kept thinking someone else is going to do this as a business or whatever. But really for me, Cali bags is social entrepreneurship. I make, I know like many of us who do social entrepreneurship, it's not something that we do that's based on making a lot of money, just enough money perhaps to do the next round of production. But mostly it is about social change, right? So we created these bags, which is just a very simple thing, the Amuredi bags, tote bags and drawstring bags that you can basically carry your rice, your sugar, your flour, your dal, your whatever, including your clothes, whatever it is, right? And it came as a 10-piece pack. And it allowed us to eliminate a lot of polythene and plastic. So what happened was, so I had this product now, 250 sets was the first production line I did. And now I want to talk about it, right? But as I'm talking about this, I'm realizing that I only have one product, right? So in order to kind of talk about it on social media, I also need to do more things with these bags. And so with these bags came for me, and this is, I think I'm so thankful, even though I created this extremely simplistic set of Amuredi bags, the bags in turn enabled me to look at everything in a very different way. And I'll explain this too as we go along. So the next, I'm going to explain the kinds of things that it changed, right? So let's start with what changed at home. And Natasha, if we can move on to the next slide. So I'm going to run through a few things that initially, right, as soon as this bag came into our lives, what changed at home and how we started doing things. And I want you to also maybe look at these things so that you also might be able to implement some of these things at your home. You may not own a home of your own. It may be shared obviously with your parents and your siblings or in your grandparents. And I must say, and I don't know if we have time to discuss this at the end, it's very challenging to live with other people who don't necessarily care about your views of the environment, right? So that was like my first experience, was coming home and kind of getting people at home to take me seriously. It was very difficult because they are like, I mean, I think they just thought I was a write-off, then they thought I was crazy, then there was huge resistance, like, oya tone vidhiyata meva karanna ba. And then there was slowly acceptance, and now there is support, right? So it's been a long journey, but let me move to the next slide so I can show you how I shop, right? So I must say that I used to shop at supermarkets, right? Because I've all my adult life thought that that was the most convenient thing to do, to shop at big supermarkets. Somewhere down the line, and I'll talk about this later, I realized that there was so much greenwashing that I was just, it didn't sit with my value system, shopping at supermarkets. And I'm not saying that this is for everybody, guys. I'm just saying this at the outset because it took me about a year and a half before I realized that supermarkets weren't my thing anymore. And so I shifted to shopping at the Arthik Madhyasthanias and the Polars and the markets. And so it became a lot easier for me to buy things. A lot of these images are pre-COVID, but let me also talk about how we can work around these things in a COVID context, right? So just in terms of stuff for the house, we buy our grains, as you can see on the picture on the right-hand side. Rice, dal, vegetables, and stuff like that we buy in our big produce bags. You see a box with some kind of like white substance, that's coconut. I'm not a fan of grating coconut at home. So I buy grated coconut, but I get them to grate it at the Polar or at the Vellavatha market or wherever it is I'm shopping at. And they'll grate them, put in a box for me. So these things, again, I'm sharing with you in the hopes that you will take this to your families. A lot of the stuff we buy, like paripu, like kadala, like all this stuff, they come in like 1 kilo polythene packs, right? So it's not just about eliminating the siri-siri bag that we bring home, right? Because that's the easiest thing for us to do. But what else comes in polythene packaging? So I had this this really horrible habit of constantly looking in my garbage bin to see how, like, what was in it, like, what was in this garbage bin that I could then eliminate, right? So I realized that, so in the picture on the right-hand side, for instance, all the things that I was buying, like paripu, like kadala, all of that came in polythene packaging, like 1 kilo packaging or 5 kilo packaging. Then you see all the arakulubadu, so you have your kahakudu, all of the miriskudu, all of these things. So I used to take glass jars. And because I was buying at a market as opposed to a supermarket, this is what I meant about value systems. And this is not for everybody. So I'm not sure how much of this you guys will be able to pitch in your own family homes. It'll be difficult. But very slowly, we started moving to purchasing all of our kulubadu and stuff like this, right? In glass jars. And then this is what we would use. Like, you know, old jam jars is what most Sri Lankan families have in their kitchens. Oil, coconut oil. I had a particular vendor who I would get it from, and they would fill up a glass bottle. Meats, I think, was the other challenging thing. So we would always take a box, that green box there, which is plastic, two plastic boxes. How we take multiple plastic boxes to the supermarkets or to the meat vendors or wherever it was, to fill it up so that we are not taking, because unlike with other polythene that you would maybe use it and then put it aside, the polythene that you use for meat, chances are you're never going to use it again, right? And even egg, we would take an old egg container. And so this is how we started shopping. But I'm also going to tell you that obviously it's a lot more challenging because of COVID. Because we're not shopping in person anymore. But I think the fact that I had managed to build relationships with the people in the store, which is the nature of shopping at kind of markets and artikas and polars, is that you have a particular relationship. So when I call them, I tell them not to, I ask them for the full list and then they will deliver it, but they will also know not to put in any polythene. They will put in one big cardboard box. And I show you pictures of how most of my groceries, even during COVID, we managed to do without polythene and plastic. There's a gonia there, you'll see, that also has polmudu, which was something else I noticed in my dustbin. We had a lot of sponges. So we started slowly replacing the sponges with polmudu, and it actually was a lot more hygienic in some sense. We have to make sure that the polkendi don't go into the sink, but overall it was more hygienic because we would use it, and on that day we would make sure that there were no chemicals in it. We throw it out and then it will go into the compost bin. And because we were changing it, see, a sponge you won't use and get rid of in a day, but I think a polmudu, you don't feel so bad to get rid of it. And these are free. Like I would get a whole bonia for like maximum of 10 rupees or whatever. So this was kind of how we shopped again. We'll talk about these things later. So this is one of the first changes we made at home. Natasha, if we can look at the next slide. Okay, so here's the other kind of biggest change that we made. About 3 years ago, we bought a big compost bin. Now, composting isn't for everybody, for sure, because you need to have garden space. I know that there are kind of smaller, more tech-savvy, smaller composting gadgets that are available, but under circumstances, I know they're very expensive, and I know not everyone can afford that kind of facility. But this is for people who have a garden. So I live on rent also. And I was a little concerned about like rats. And I know this is one of the first things that people talk about when you talk of compost. But it really depends on how you compost also and how you manage your compost. So for us, it's only vegetable scraps that we put in. And we realized like one of the things that really changed in our home was that we started segregating our garbage. So we started segregating glass separately, polkadot separately, tin separately, paper, compostables, and then plastic, because there's still some level of plastic that does come home. And then things that are batteries separately. And I know it sounds like a lot, but really, now say for instance, this is actually a picture of my garbage bin, and I remember when I posted, my friends are like, oh, that's such a pretty picture. It's like, no, but that's inside of my garbage bin. It's not very pretty. But the fact is that once you segregate it, and you're not including meats and bones and stuff like that, it doesn't smell bad also. Compost bins do, for certain, if you don't manage it properly, but it's just a matter of managing, and then it kind of manages itself after a while, because that's the ecosystem that you create. Now, you don't necessarily need to go purchase a bin if you do have garden space. I'm not sure how many of you in this discussion today have the ability to actually cordon off a space in your own gardens, but there are other ways of building kind of compost beds and compost pits within your garden without having to purchase a polythene or a plastic bin in the way in which we did. Which in hindsight wasn't probably the smartest thing, but it was what I knew at the time, right? So that's why I said it's very much about a journey that I'm sharing. So there are lots of kind of negatives also, which I'm going to have to be honest about. But what's interesting is it automatically transformed our garden. I live near the zoo, and anyway, there's this really fantastic bird life here. But what happened was the compost bin also started in... bringing in more birds, more variety of birds, because they were interested in all the worms. And so we have this mini little bird watching space at the back in our small garden space at the back, thanks to composting. So that's one of the like biggest and most wonderful changes that have happened in our home front, for which I'm very thankful. Here's something that we also did quite immediately. So Natasha, there's the next slide. So skipping the birthday stuff, okay? So I'm someone, I have two kids, as I said. My daughter is 5.5, my son's 3.5. But one of our biggest challenges was, obviously, I don't know how many of you have noticed, but birthdays in general, now because we're looking at a world of Instagram and social media in which everything is just so beautiful, right? And you see these beautiful kind of, you know, balloons in different colors, not just like the regular balloons that, you know, that we grew up with when we were very young, for the older end of people on the spectrum, but the other kind of foil balloons and stuff like that. And a lot of thematic stuff, right? So I know with my kids, like with Aheli, it's all about like Frozen and Disney princess stuff. And yeah, like just a whole bunch of like dinosaurs. And then with my son, I mean, he's still getting used to stuff, but I know that a lot of my friends also engage in and want to put together really beautiful and Instagram savvy or just beautiful birthdays for their children, right? And for themselves also. So I felt quite like this was really challenging for me because I have family and like the kids have grandparents who have very particular ideas on what birthdays should look like. And when I said no balloons at birthdays, that was like, I don't know. I think that was like the most shocking thing to them. And they were just completely disturbed by me. So one of the things that we did was, it wasn't just changing kind of the birthdays themselves, but really looking at everything that was single use, right? So if we were having, like previously we would have had single use plastic cups, single use plastic, not plastic or plastic or paper plates. I would have, you know, I mean, it would have been very different, but then I realized that that's not, I mean, I can't be talking about being environmentally friendly and then forget all of that on one day. So the challenge was then to find a way to not do that, right? And I think one of the most interesting takeaways for me, I'm now 36, was looking at my own childhood birthdays in which we didn't have throwaway cups and throwaway plates. And we had these really nice, small, intimate birthday parties with the kids in the neighborhood at best. If there ever was one, someone cut a cake somewhere and that was it. And I never felt robbed of my childhood or of a birthday because there wasn't a thematic fancy birthday party thrown for me. And so I wanted to instill those same values in my kids in some sense. Now with my kids being of an age where they watch certain cartoons or they watch or they, you know, they go to school and they share the space with other people, it's certainly challenging. So for my daughter's birthday this year, I don't have a picture. She was so hell-bent on Frozen. Luckily, we had a friend who had given us a dress, a secondhand dress that belonged to her daughter, of a Frozen dress, an Elsa dress, like a just a regular dress with a small Elsa print. And another friend loaned us a few cake toppers. And so we didn't purchase anything. And that was a birthday. And she had the most fantastic birthday. But birthdays and celebrations in general, not just birthdays, but looking at all celebrations in a more sustainable way was something that we did quite early on, right? So if we can move to the next slide. I'm just going to also talk about something that changed pretty fast. Now, I thought I had brought it with me, but I don't have this. So this is what, so one of the things that I also found really challenging were personal hygiene products, right? I know, again, we have a spectrum of people here, but I'm going to be really honest because I think periods are things that we should be able to talk about quite openly. So one of the biggest challenges were also in using sanitary pads, right? And you know, I just want to share something with you that I learned very recently also, in that sanitary pads take between 500 and 800 years to decompose. So that's basically, if you look at it, that's over like every single proper sanitary napkin that's ever been made since the inception of sanitary napkins has never decomposed. It's all here, right? I think that was just so shocking to me. But this is something that a friend recommended. It's called a period cup. It's not for everyone, but I genuinely recommend for those of you who might be a little older, who want to, you know, maybe try this, read up on it. It's a really interesting way of making sure you're not, I mean, it's a cup that you wear, so you no longer need sanitary napkins. Another option for people who are a little worried about the invasiveness of a cup, especially for the girls out there, is using reusable cloth pads, right? It's something that, again, it's not for everyone and it's not all the time, but even for maybe perhaps when you're home as opposed to going to school, or you're going to uni or you're traveling. I mean, there are different ways in which you can do it. As a result of just these products, I've managed to eliminate using regular sanitary pads. It's also a huge saving because in a normal household where there's, say, more than one or two women in the household, sanitary napkins is something that's really, in the long run, going to cost you a lot. That period cup is going to last you for over 8 years. It's going to cost you only between 2,000 and 3,000 rupees. Like I said, it's not for everyone, but I wanted to be able to talk about this. Another challenge that I had as a young mother was managing the kids' diapers. And I remember one of the first things that I did was with my first one, I did everything wrong because I used regular diapers. But with my second one, I switched him to reusable diapers. And what you see, the white cloth that you see are the towel liners that used to be inserted in these reusable diapers that he could kind of grow into. And he used them for like a year, for over 2 years. And they were very useful, and we passed it on to somebody else. So these are also useful and important things when talking about the changes that we can make at home. So I want to now move into things that took us a little longer to learn, right? So like I said, some things were pretty obvious, very easy to move, very easy to change. And some other things took us much, much longer. So if we move to the next slide, this is a place that I shop at the most. This is Ruan, who is packing everything into a polythene bag for someone else, not for me. But one of the most challenging things for me has been, or one of the most interesting things for me, has been this self-realization of understanding how we purchase stuff, right? So from going from purchasing at supermarkets to one day waking up and realizing that there was something quite insincere about the systems in which we had built at supermarkets, right? Especially some of the large, I'm not going to share names and get anyone here, including the organizers, in trouble. But I found that there was a lot of insincerity in how some of the larger supermarkets were greenwashing. I don't know if you've heard that term earlier. For some of you who are younger, it may not be a familiar term. Again, it's a term that I learned quite recently also. But you know, you've heard the term whitewashing, right? You heard, like, basically it's just whitewashing something bad, but making it look good by just coating over it. So greenwashing in some sense is also something that's essentially bad for the environment, but you present it in a particular way by either just introducing particular colors, introducing particular very small measures through CSR or through even product development to make it look like you're an eco-friendly brand or company. And that can be horribly dangerous. And the more I thought about it, the more convinced I was that supermarket chains were really not sitting with my value system. And so I shifted my patterns of purchase. It started with supermarkets, it started with like the bigger places, but it also then became about kind of shopping at smaller vendors close to home, not like if it was about bread, buying from a small bakery close to home, if it's about fish, waiting for a Malu uncle to come home. So you are reliant on a larger group of people. But as a result of that, and this is something that I must also share, I don't know again if this is for all of you, but I am so invested myself. This is may not be the best advice also for everyone, but I am really invested in building communities, right? It's something that's very much a part of who I am and something that I really enjoy doing and I love. And I realized that it's very difficult to do that if you're going to be living very kind of selfish lives in how you interact with people on a day-to-day basis. So as a result of knowing all these vendors, like in my area, I would know most vendors, right? Most vendors on the street, from the person who sells sambili to the person who sells fruit on the streets. And I know that their livelihoods are very dependent on these purchases. And so there's a relationship. So we are also talking not just about kind of eco-friendly purchasing systems, but we're also talking about how to build relationships. And I think that's essential. We're talking about changing the world and healing the world and building better spaces for all of us. And we can't do that just by switching to eco-friendly products overnight. It also means that we have to talk to people, encourage people, build our communities. And so these are really, really vital parts of it. So I changed a lot of stuff. Like, it wasn't just patterns of purchasing. It was also patterns of how I interacted with other parts of my community. For instance, some other kind of socio-political things happened in our spaces. We built a small residence association to deal with some of the stuff we have. Whenever we have a problem, there's a way in which we can go to the council. I know this. Some of this might be a little alien to some of you, and it might not sound like, it might sound really far-fetched, right? But it took me a long time to realize how privileged I was in not needing to access so many services. So for instance, it meant that I started using the local clinic instead of going to private clinics. I started taking my children to the local clinic, to the midwife. So these are all changes that actually started happening. Like the political, social, and economical kinds of environments also started fitting in, kind of this puzzle started fitting together a lot more neatly when I paid better attention to the environment. And the environment I don't see as this only looking at kind of trees and greenery kind of environment, but looking, being very reflective of the whole structure of things, right? So shopping patterns change, and also understand that we didn't have to purchase everything that we saw. I'll talk about that a little later because I have a separate slide on it. Okay, so if I can move to the next slide. This is also based on the shifting of patterns of purchasing. So this is just something that I, this little white note is because I know some of you might ask me, so how in COVID do you get your stuff? I wish they hadn't taped that down, but this is a way in which I, so when I send in my grocery list to a small store here down in the Hivala, I always make mention, I say, please pack all items in cardboard box, please don't add any polythene, don't pack items in separate bags, just place everything together in the same box, with an emoji of a box, and then say thank you. And they find it quite funny because they're like, madam, do we put the toilet stuff with the food stuff? And I'm like, yeah, I mean, it's not really a very big deal because a lot of those things, I mean, if you look at it, like if you go and do your groceries, you'll come back with at least 12 to 15 polythene bags, right? So this is a foolproof way of making sure that the supermarket also takes, it's not a big supermarket, it's a small market in our area, a small kade, a little bigger than a sillara kade. But you can even manage the same things during COVID because you can't go in and take your bag. And I mean, if you couldn't, if it was during a lockdown, this is another way in which you can deal with it. So I just want to move now to the next slide, which is talking about something I already spoke about before, which is recycling and greenwashing. Two very different things, but I want to talk about how they used to connect and how my mind used to work, right? And I know a lot of you also might see this because this is a power of greenwashing. In some of the supermarkets and in general, you'll find a lot of these larger brands, specifically like Beamer bottle brands or like soda brands, cola brands, right? Talking about how you can just, you know, they are going to be doing everything right. Just buy your water, buy your drink, buy your whatever, and come back and leave your plastic and we will take care of it. What I want to also say is that I was okay with this, right? So I would do my grocery shopping at the supermarket. And as I was going in weekly, I would come and just put all my plastic in. And I would be like, oh, someone's going to take care of it now and it's going to get sorted. And out of sight and out of mind, right? But the reality is in Sri Lanka, we don't have the capacity to manage this kind of plastic waste in the capacity in which we're kind of getting rid of it, right? And if there is contamination, which in many cases there are, I don't know how you, if you've noticed, and now with COVID, I don't even know if these kind of plastic cages exist anymore. But you will find like in public spaces, when you have this kind of thing, people would come and even put a bath packet into it, right? Because we're just so... like kunubaldi ke na kunubaldi, they don't particularly care about segregation. But what I realized was this was really irresponsible of me because it was these companies and brands that were eating into my thinking pattern, telling me, okay, so these are the brands that you can use, and it doesn't matter. We will take care of your plastic waste after. But realistically, that isn't something that happens. I also want to say that, I mean, it's very harmful because we don't realize that that's what we've been taught and that's what we've known, right? It doesn't occur to us. And I think that's really dangerous. So that's something that changed. I know we don't have a lot more time, so I'm going to, because we want to leave some time for questions. So I'm going to go into the next slide. The next slide now. Which is reimagining gifting, because that's another thing that we do. We do a lot of gifting, right? And when we gift things, as a mom, I receive a lot of love for my children by in the way of gifts from friends, right? And so there should be a whole bunch of plastic toys, plastic. And it used to be really, really, really difficult for me because I'm also going to say a lot of the plastic toys, I don't know if you know this, but a lot of the plastic toys that we have cannot be recycled. They cannot be recycled, right? So can you imagine the amount of plastic toys a child goes through in like the first 7-8 years of their lives, which is when they're gifted most plastic stuff, different kinds of toys. So I'm here to tell you, as you are gifting people things, please try to rethink how you gift, right? So one of the first things on the screen is like this little bird, a little bird cage, and it was really sweet. And this was my Aurudu gift to my parents and to ourselves. And I took this, and I remember the uncle who sold this to me. He was out of Colombo, and he said that this was a, like, he said, you know, he was very sweet. He said, it's a new year, and this is a new home for someone else, like for the birds. But what I mean, the way in which he said it was so beautiful, that it was a new home for someone else. And I thought, what an apt and beautiful gift. So that was something I gifted. I know the pictures aren't very clear because, I mean, I've included the Kelly bags, which is a different story. A friend bought me this, the rose, the plant on my birthday this year, and I thought it was really beautiful because as it grows in my garden, every as I water it every day, I'm reminded of her, and it's a beautiful way. And every time there's a new flower that appears, I send her pictures, and I'm reminded of our friendship and how grateful I am that she chose a gift that reflected my values also. And I thought it was very sweet. And at the bottom, really, that picture has been cropped, but it's a picture of coffees that I had made for a friend. And so now we've shifted from giving kind of gifts because actually, if we can move to the next slide, Natasha, it's the same, I realize it's the same image that's been reused again in some sense. But I've been more reflective about what I receive and what I give. And so even to our families, who are very resistant, I've been asking them to please be more mindful about what they give the kids. So the picture at the bottom is my daughter in April turned 5, and her favorite fruit is banana. So we asked her what she wanted for her birthday, and obviously she said I asked her what kind of tree she would like to plant, and she said and it was also close to the Aurudu Nakata for planting a tree because she's born in April. So she said a banana tree. So of course we got her a banana tree, and that banana tree is now almost 2 stories tall. And we're hoping that by her next birthday, we will be able to have bananas for her. But that was her birthday present. It wasn't, at least by us, we did have some polythene and plastic. My kids are very reliant on secondhand stuff, as am I now. That's my son holding a set of books that he received 2 days ago. A lot of our gifts that we receive for the kids, I encourage parents and friends to buy secondhand stuff, like secondhand books, not to buy new stuff. For children, it doesn't matter if it's new or old. It's just new to them. And I think it's the same value system that I share now. It's just really, really a wonderful way of seeing things. So we imagine, reimagining how we gift things and what we give and receive and tell people about. I think that's really important. So I'm going to move away from that section and move into the next one, which is what we had to unlearn, right? So as much as we've been learning on this journey of trying to figure out how to be more conscious at home, we also had to unlearn a whole bunch of stuff which we had carried with us all our lives, and it has been really challenging for us. So I'm going to move to that first slide, which is valuing the old. I want you to take a look at this picture because I think when we talk of living kind of eco-friendly, we already assume that it means that we're going to swipe, like kind of make sure that there isn't a single bit of polythene or plastic in a polythene we can get rid of. So just to let you know, also we have a polythene ban at home. We weren't going to wait till the government introduced one. We implemented a bit of a polythene ban, which means you don't purchase anything that comes in polythene, right? Ideally, that's the way we want it to work. And we also make sure that when we go out, even if friends come home, we tell them, if you can avoid giving us stuff that's packed in polythene, just bring it without any kind of package. But the picture there is of my son playing with some of the stuff. We receive a lot of secondhand plastic toys. Because it's secondhand, we will use it carefully and pass it on to somebody. I think this cooking set is over like over 10 or 12 years old. It belonged to a friend, and her sons used it, and now my son and daughter use it, mostly my son, because he enjoys cooking. And so, I mean, it's the purpose that I teach my kids is quite a lot, is that we are so conscious. I mean, in our world, we are so used to understanding and really only valuing things that are new, because that's what this kind of capitalist world tells us, that we must have new things. Otherwise, it's of no value. It has to be new and shiny and bright. But you talk to a child, or you re-gift something to a child, and you'll notice so much of what they use. They don't particularly care if it's new or shiny. It's just new to them. And this is something that I think I have really taken to heart. I'm sitting here in a room. I'm just wondering whether I should do this or not. I am seated here because it's the quietest room in the house. And I'm surrounded by bags and bags and bags of stuff that people have gotten rid of, like all things from their homes, which are of no value to them, but of immense value to a lot of the people that I work with from underserved communities in Colombo and out of Colombo. So I am going to do this. I'm just going to show you very quickly. I'm assuming, can you guys see me? You can see me also. Natasha, can you just coordinate if you can see me and just say yes? Someone can say yes. Okay, just for a second. So I'm just going to show you very quickly. These are just stuff. My house looks a little manic. I understand it's not ideal, but it's just stuff that belongs to other people. There are clothes, there are old plastic boxes. There are old books. There are old bed sheets. There's an old blackboard. And on that side, I know that's polythene bags, but they came in those bags. And I don't know how much. And there's another room upstairs. It's full just like this. And the reason I know it sounds manic, all of this stuff goes to a family tomorrow in Kurunagala who have no access to stuff. And over the last few years in particular, one of the things that have really changed in my home is that I've been collecting more stuff on behalf of people also. I don't know how much more I can accommodate of the same thing. Natasha, we can go back to the slides if that. I'll give you a few seconds to coordinate. I'm sorry for having to ask you to move in and out of this. But I mean, what is garbage of no value to you, maybe, or value to somebody else? And it doesn't mean that you need to kind of dump it all in somebody's home and like get rid of it like that. But I think if you learn to take care of your stuff, so my kids, I don't buy them clothes anymore. They share their clothes with people who are older than them, who then they receive their clothes. And then we also take care, really good care of their clothes, and we pass them down to somebody else. And so it creates value in everything that we own, right? I have this really old water bottle. It's not really old, actually. It's only 2 years old, but the paint keeps coming off. And every time a friend of mine sees this, they're always like, again, I don't know if you guys can see me, but all my friends are constantly like, you know, we are going to get you a new bottle. That bottle is horrendous. That bottle is ugly. But it serves its purpose. And I'm just always shocked by how invested we are in making things beautiful, because if it's not perfect, we don't want it anymore. And I think that's a really dangerous narrative, right? And the last slide I think I have here, the one before the last slide, is on challenging consumerism by building sharing systems. So that's what I just showed you, all of these things that we will share. I don't own everything that I need in my own home. I am very reliant on my neighbors. There are certain things that we share, from appliances to other stuff. And I think that is what it means to be, because we're so in this kind of socio-economic or political space that has been built for us, we want everything to be our own, right? We see so much stuff on Facebook, on Instagram, on social media, on the television that tells us we must own the newest phone, the newest laptop, the prettiest dress, the newest makeup palette, the newest this, the newest that. But I think we really have to ask ourselves, who's telling us this? Why are we believing this, right? And so a lot of what we wear and what we, you know, how we live is very much based on a shared system. And I don't think it's something, I think it's this very capitalistic world that tells us that we should be ashamed of that. And I don't think I think we need to reflect on why the world is telling us that. So a lot of what we do is shared. A lot of what we own is shared. And it's a really beautiful system, because it's a system that enables us. It's a system that allows us to care for our neighbors, to care for our families, to care for people around us in our communities. And guys, I must say this, it's not difficult to do, right? And all of this is something that, I mean, maybe the sharing systems I've been involved in for a much longer period, because I was also quite reliant on shared systems for living pretty much all my adult life. But with everything else, it's all quite new information. Like I said, it's been fitting in quite nicely as a puzzle. And so this is my challenge to you, to also try to do, to be conscious of this. So I'm going to move into that very last slide, which is really reflecting on what you can do. What can I do? Right? What can I do? So start with yourself. Don't always assume that to change the environment requires, listen, I think we need to start with ourselves in order to be able to hold the government accountable for what they're doing. We need to start with ourselves in order to be able to understand what corporates are doing so that we can hold them accountable. But we need to make our part work also. And I think that's something that I didn't understand. So I didn't quite understand what my role was up until I started getting engaged in these spaces, only with the education. Like, okay, simply, if I didn't really know how I could engage up until the time, in my own home, my own garbage problems, I didn't know what I could do until I started engaging and then questioning the council, for instance, or questioning the other kind of larger systems. I couldn't do that unless I also had done it first and then asked, are there solutions for these things? So that's something I recommend you do. Second is try to influence your friends and family. And some things you can only practice, you have to practice what you preach in order to be able to do that. My friends jokingly position me near plastic bottles and silly bags and take pictures of me and say they're going to use it as blackmail, just because they know that I'm so mortified of being seen around these things because I don't use them. And, I'm just like, no, we will do without it. But I have friends who are now apologize when they take me to their children's birthday parties. I feel really bad about it, but I realize how much of an impact my constant badgering has made, because I'd be like, I'm sorry about the reusable cups. So it comes with a bit of a disclaimer. The third thing I want to say is build consciousness. Sorry, the words might look kind of all together, but build a consciousness in the clubs that you work with. I know many of you here are from schools and clubs and things like that, right? So one of the things that I did in one of the political networks that I work in, was that once I joined their organization, one of the first things I said was, okay, for any of these events that I am, we are organizing, I also come, I mean, one of the things that we always do is every time we had a press conference, there were plastic bottles left on the table. If we had a talk show, there were plastic bottles left on the table. It would drive me livid, because here we are talking about the environment and the world, and there were plastic bottles left on the table. So I said, that's not going to happen. Either you tell the guests early on, or you tell the people attending the conference to bring their own bottle, or we provide glass bottles, right? So we started, I think glass bottles were an expensive thing for us to manage. So we started telling guests to please bring their own bottle. And it was a very small thing, but it's an idea of creating that consciousness in those spaces that you work in, right? Do you need the additional printouts? Do you really need to purchase XXXXX? Do you really need that extra flex? Like, what are you going to do with that flex afterwards? Stuff like that, right? The next thing I'd like to say is to create a guide for the space that you work in. There are things that you can do if you're already in an organization. There are certain guides like that you can create so that you can work better within the space and for other organizations and vendors that you work with, right? Every time you buy something, before you buy something, ask yourself, what will happen to this product when I'm done with it, right? Be it a bottle, a phone, a file cover. I don't know, I'm just looking in this room and everything else. Like, whatever you purchase, realize that is going to be waste someday. Someday, somewhere on this planet, that is waste. So ask yourself what is going to happen to it, and ask yourself if you really need it. If you do really need it, what is the best alternative or the least harmful alternative to the planet, right? And lastly, be open to learning and unlearning. And as adults, I mean, if you're 14 or 15 or 16 and listening to this, I really, really, really think you have a far greater chance of changing and unlearn and kind of being this person than having to wait a whole 30 something years, 33 years before being able to acknowledge this. My daughter is 5 and a half. Yesterday, I was just not having it. I didn't want to cook. We very rarely eat from out. I bought a chicken pie that came already cooked inside a foil container. And I feed her a lot of information about the environment, but I wasn't prepared for it when she came and told me, "Mama, what happens to the planet with this container?" And I felt so bad. Like, I was so impressed with her. She's 5 and a half. And she's like, "Can this be recycled?" So then I actually Googled. I was like, "Can this be recycled? How do we recycle foil?" Because it's not something that we have at home quite often. I was just so, so, so impressed that at 5 and a half, she cared about what would happen to that product. And I think the younger you are and the sooner you learn this, the better it would be for all of us. We have this huge, huge, huge responsibility towards the planet, towards this place that we call home. And I've only just started this journey. And I'm glad that I have this opportunity today to share this with you. And I hope in some small, small way, there's something in like the hundreds of things that I've said today that you can pick up, or not hundreds, but you know, maybe 10 or 15 things that I said today that you can pick up and try to implement in your own home, in your own way. And I wish you the very, very best of luck with trying to do that. I know I might have talked for a little longer than I should have, but I think we have about 10 minutes or 15 minutes now for questions.
Thank you for that very, very inspiring and insightful talk, Ray. We're very, very grateful to have had you on board. We will be getting into question time now, and we have a raised hand. I believe we have a question. So let's start with FEI coordinator.
I would like to ask, will we be getting the recording, and how do we get the recycle bags right now during this time, because it's really hard to get a few types of things, and because it's really hard to get things from markets, because my parents usually use Food City and they have close people there, and we don't really have bags that we could use, but we do use bags, as in when we get plastic bags, we put them in a bucket kind of, and then we use them again when we need to either put files in or documents in, so we won't have to buy different plastic bags.
Yeah, that's really great. Thank you for both those questions. I think the first question, Natasha will be able to answer because she will tell you when you're going to get the recording. The second question I can answer, which is on how you can get the bag. So if you can go to the Cali Reusable Bags page, those are the bags that I sell. But I must say, I'm not trying to plug it here and promote just this bag. If there's a way in which you can get a bag that's similar to that sewn, that's also a really easy way of getting it done. If that's inconvenient, I also sell bags. We retail at a couple of places, including like Celine and the Good Market and Barefoot and places like that. But we can also deliver. But that aside, and I just want to say that sounds like a marketing plug, and I feel a little guilty for being able to do that. But that aside, I understand what you're saying in terms of, you know, reusing your polythene bags. But at some point, it becomes non-usable. Like it either tears or it won't become usable. So ideally, just to make sure that you're reducing your polythene intake or bringing any polythene back home, you should try to take containers. If you go to Food City, you can it doesn't have to only be bags. You can take containers, like plastic containers, and bring that stuff. I think with cloth bags, things like rice and dal and other stuff, you can actually store in the cloth bag, right? Whatever kind of cloth bag you take, you can store it in, as long as there's a drawstring and it's airtight. Or you can take containers also. So I know these are not usual ways of take, like you don't usually do it, but maybe encourage your parents and see how they respond to it. Maybe you can go with them one day and kind of ease them into it. Try one product at a time, one product a week, and then see how you go about it.
We have another question saying, could you please share any ideas of how to create a compost bin for those who are living in apartments?
Okay, so that's tough. I was hoping it would be an easier question. I know there are, okay, so there are a few ways to go about it. One is that depends on the apartment building that you live in. There are some apartments that do have like garden space. I've heard of community composting, like where you have within the apartment complex, you write to everybody in the management, or you write to the management and you put this idea across. And so the entire complex has a small compostable space, right? Now that might be really difficult for you. So if you're living in an apartment, I've also seen, like I said at the beginning, smaller units that kind of compost your stuff very quickly, like in a day, like it breaks down everything, but it's not ideal. So it's not, I think at this point in time, a possibility for people who live in apartments. You can, I think, try, but it might be a little messier. It might be a little messier than having your own garden space for sure.
We have another question that says, taking all of your great ideas into consideration, what are some of the key projects or activities that one can implement at the school level? Keeping in mind that many schools today have very efficient systems in place for separating garbage, garbage collection, garbage disposal, etc.
So I think with schools, like you said, a lot of these schools already have really wonderful systems in place. I think a lot of schools from out of Colombo, in fact, have much better systems in place than some of the schools within Colombo. And I say this because, again, now with COVID becomes more challenging, but because of the fact that they have limited resources, that automatically makes them, more... it makes them sometimes explore those ideas, those options. So I'm also trying to figure out if there are things that would immediately come to mind. But basically, I think instilling those values in the minds of young people is a huge challenge. Sometimes you have all these multiple wonderful things that happen, but how much of that do you take home then? I know a lot of like Colombo schools, it's not like, you know, people in the younger generation don't have a concept of recycling or segregation. So it's done at like a larger school level, but how much of that, how conscious are we as individuals of the impact of that? So for instance, like book swaps, guys, like those things, like sharing, like you bring, you can have a thrift day where everyone brings in their old clothes or whatever. And with COVID becomes a little more, all of these ideas are more challenging, right? But you can have a thrift day where you all bring in your clothes and you have like a sharing. You can do it with your friends. I do it with my friends, where we all, when we're meeting at a friend's birthday or something, we all bring our clothes and then everyone picks. And so it's a new item that we have for each other. You can swap, have book swaps, but like building, I mean, there are multiple activities that you can do. It's just a matter of, I think it's not just about composting and growing plants, but about the systems of sharing so that you're not purchasing new things. So maybe focus on that. I think that's easier under the circumstances because I don't think a lot of us have very deep pockets. So these are the ways around it.
We have another question asking, are balloons not environmentally friendly? And if so, what can we use as an alternative to parties?
Yeah, so no balloons, guys. They are horrible for the environment on so many levels. My kids really dislike it when I say this. I know they went for my nephew's birthday last week and they brought back a whole bunch of balloons because I don't allow them to use balloons at home. They brought back balloons from somebody else's birthday party and they're sitting here at home. But alternatives in a sense, I think you can be creative. So we use a lot of, so this is not ideal, okay? It's not going to take away from that. But instead of like things like confetti, I've seen it's really beautiful. You know, when you use you have these paper punchers that come in different shapes. You can punch old, like really horrible, like you're going to get rid of magazine paper, or you can even punch old leaves into beautiful shapes. I know they use this as wedding confetti. Balloons, I'm sorry, I don't think there's an alternative for it. But I mean, one of the things that we try to do to dress up the house for birthdays and stuff like that is that I have invested in a few plants. It's very selfish, very selfish. Every time there's a birthday, I'm like, we need a plant. So we just have a couple of extra biggish plants sitting around the house during those days. There's no proper alternative for things like that. But I think it's about being creative, using some, and if you have things from, like balloons are single use, right? But there are things that I know that we bought for the kids many years ago that we like little paper lanterns and stuff that we keep reusing year after year. I mean, I'm not going to just get rid of them because suddenly overnight we're eco-conscious, right? These exist. So we will carefully use them and reuse them over and over again. Also, instead of purchasing, guys, try to share and rent like other stuff. Like sometimes I know on these mom's groups that I'm on, and I think it can be replicated even in like school friends groups, birthday groups. So basically, if one mom has a birthday with a particular theme today, she will share that and say, does anyone want this kind of thematic birthday stuff? And then carefully collect it and then give it to somebody else. And then that mom will use it. And then the following mom will use it. So I think even amongst friends, I mean, if you're worried about having to use something somebody else used, that's the capitalist world talking to you guys. So unlearn those things. And just be really, really confident that someone else is using the stuff that you gave, or that you have the amazing power and this amazing, wonderful story of being able to use something that somebody else gave you.
We're down to our last four questions. So the first one of which is we had a session on unsustainable fishing last week. And, you know, the kind of destruction it causes to the ocean beds and the ecosystems and as a whole. So how can we contribute in a way that we purchase seafood consciously, or is there a way that we can avoid buying seafood from certain places? What are your thoughts on this?
Okay, so this is not something that I'm an expert on. So I really genuinely don't know. And to be honest, and I'll be really, really honest here, after Express Pearl for many, many months, still we are not back to eating fish, right? I mean, big fish, small fish, across the board, we're just so, so nervous about eating fish. We had an old Malu uncle who used to come home every once a week with his big kadha all the way from Panadura. And he no longer comes because no one's buying fish from him. His livelihood has completely changed. So in answer to what you're saying, I don't think I am an expert in that area, and I don't have a direct answer. In the event that we do want some fish, we do take our boxers and go and purchase it from a local vendor. It's very difficult for us to decipher between who is getting fish from where and what the extent of the destruction of Express Pearl has done. I mean, I don't think for the next so many months or years we're going to know. So I am a lot more cautious. I think our family has turned a little less. I mean, we're not vegetarian at all. I mean, by any means, but even fish is now something that sadly we are, we don't have anymore because we are nervous about it. I'm sorry. That's the only kind of honest answer I can give you.
That's perfectly fine. Another question is on greenwashing. How applicable and practical do you think an ethical or green certification scheme would be in Sri Lanka? Do you think that if we have a project like that, consumers will be able to look through and say, okay, this brand is ethically friendly, or will you find corporations using this as another greenwashing mechanism in the future?
I found that in my very small understanding of the world and greenwashing, that corporates find ways to navigate through even the hardest and the toughest suggestions. So for instance, I mean, I know this, some of you might already know, but you know, when they were talking about sachet packets and banning sachet packets, one particular company was very smart in increasing 4 milliliters each. It was anything over 20 milliliters, anything under 20 milliliters, you weren't allowed to put into a sachet. So they increased 1 milliliter per sachet and made it a pack of 4 24-milliliter sachets. And I was just thinking, like, how incredibly intelligent the corporates are in navigating through all of this. But also there's a market for it, Natasha. I'm going to be honest again with you guys. I mean, for those of us who can afford to buy certain products like shampoo in big bulk, in 700, 600 rupee bottles, or even 230, 240 rupee bottles, is a far cry from the majority of people, even in Colombo, who just can't manage to, you know, buy a kilo of rice to feed their families. So I think now more than ever, we can talk about it within our own circles. We can talk about buying bulk, being eco-friendly, blah, blah. But it's very difficult for families like that. I have had experiences when I go and I talk to underserved communities about how they can access stuff. And they're like, but we can't afford to buy shampoo for that amount. So we're just going to have to do with the sachet. And even the sachet, they will use 2 or 3 times, right? So green certification, I mean, I think it's certainly something we should strive for. right? I'm not saying that we do it and it's going to set up and it's going to fail. I think it's just going to be a lot more challenging under the circumstances, but it's something that we should certainly try to be, because we need to be holding corporates accountable. It's the corporates that are really the ones that damage the planet the most. It's not you or I. And in order to hold them accountable, we also need to understand what's happening globally.
Last two questions, the first of which is, we have in the UK charity shop concepts, which are particularly popular, and it's a great way to, you know, reuse with little or no impact and also contribute to society. In your experience, are there charity shops as such or similar available in Sri Lanka, or why do you think is it difficult for it to kind of occur here?
I really like that question, because I'm in the middle of trying to, at this very point in time, start up a tiny little charity, a little thrift store for secondhand items that will be done via some of the youth in Kompanivedia in Colombo. And one of the biggest, I mean, we're still at the very preliminary stages, because I get a lot of secondhand stuff, as you can see, and some of that is resellable. So we wanted to make it a business model where someone's able to make money off it. And I know a lot of our Sri Lankans, when they go overseas, the first thing that they'll do is go to visit a thrift shop for their jackets, for their shoes, for their boots, for whatever, right? But here, I think it's just a lot of cultural stigma. Like, you never want to wear something that somebody has worn before. There's so much stigma about it, like even in our own families. And I remember the conversations I had in this very home about secondhand shoes for the kids. And it's like, yeah, I am a karani. And now we're just like, oh, looking at it. So it certainly is challenging. I think it's a cultural understanding of kind of valuing secondhand stuff. And why would you pay, this idea of why would you pay money if someone's already worn it, right? It's so outdated. But I'm so glad to see on Instagram and on Facebook, there are lots of groups like the Pre-Loved group. I know that there are individuals who are looking at like online thrift stores. There are also online thrift stores with very expensive designer Sri Lankan wear. So I think these are really great concepts. It's great that we are starting somewhere, but it's not accessible to the masses as yet. And I think that's something we should attempt to do, because it's a really good business model for someone, even in a Vatta in Colombo, to try to do. So I think it's a cultural thing, really, but we must change it.
And one of our audience members is asking, why is it bad to buy new clothes in the first place?
Why is it bad to buy secondhand clothes?
No, brand new clothes, rather.
Why is it? Okay, I can answer that. I mean, I think it's not that it's bad to buy brand new clothes, but I think you have to understand that a lot of what we wear is what we call fast fashion, right? And the amount of clothing that ends up in garbage dumps is huge, right? The amount of clothing that ends up in waste as waste is also huge. I mean, I don't know on average how many, I mean, there are certain, not everyone has the same ethics and values in looking after their clothes. So some people after like 5 wears or maybe 10 wears are like, oh, I can't be seen wearing this again, which is a very kind of newish thing that I'm also seeing. Like, oh, I can't be seen, because you're also presenting yourself so much in the public space, right? So it's about Instagram pictures or on social media pictures, and oh my gosh, I've been seen in this 3 times. I can't be seen in this. It's a very superficial kind of space. I really admire people who've been wearing the same saris like for 30 years. I think that's what we should be aiming for. Because fast fashion is a problem. It is a huge problem for waste. So every time you buy something, like I said in my last slide, ask yourself, what is this going to do to the planet? And like for years, for people like me, for years, I worked in television for 10 years, which meant like every other show, I would attempt to try to wear something new. And it was a lot of clothes, guys. Like, yes, when they didn't fit me, I passed it on to someone else, but I should have never purchased so many clothes anyway. That's why there's a problem. Fast fashion is a problem. More sustainable ways of looking at how you source your fabrics, what kind of, I mean, it's all chemicals, it's all earth's resources that are being used to produce the fabric, the lining, the buttons, the thread that goes into stitching these, and how wearable are they? And how long-term can they be used? So I think those are all things that you need to factor in as you're buying something new.
And our final question for the day is, we've spoken a lot about what we can do from a consumer side and from a demand side, But is there anything that we can do from a supply side, looking at, you know, suppliers, producers, manufacturers, or even the government, that we can kind of push towards moving away from this business model, perhaps? Or what are your thoughts on this kind of?
So that's a really heavy question. And I think in order to be able to answer that, I think we need a I don't want to leave it at something political, but I think we have to understand that the politics or in the way in which our countries run are based on the politics that we do. And in that sense, I think those are the structures that enable the supplier angle, right? So I think in order to change some of that, I mean, I know there are smaller businesses that are looking at changing their business models. There are businesses that are becoming more eco-centric, more value-driven, more about, you know, not just mass production of things, but also looking at really how, and also understanding the impact of their production on in every step of the way on the environment, right? But I think for a better part, a lot of the larger organizations, companies, conglomerates really gloss over it. And then they make peace with it by doing a CSR project and then kind of trying to balance it out. And that's the most dangerous thing. And we can sit here talking about CSR projects and corporates for the rest of our days. But really that is, we have to acknowledge that that's very dangerous and it's very difficult to navigate through. And so in order, in my world or in my mind, in order to change all of this, it means requiring, I think, socio-political change, which is a much broader thing. But as long as we start at home on some level, we may be able to someday see the bigger picture also. That's my aspiration.
Well, thank you so much again for your time and all your insights. It's been a really, really inspiring time to listen to you talk. And thank you everyone for sending in your questions. Once again, thank you to everyone who's joined in for our webinar. And if you have any additional questions or would like to connect directly with the FEO team, you can either reach out directly using our website or you can reach out via Facebook or Instagram. So once again, thanks, Ray. Thank you, everyone, for your time and have a wonderful rest of your day. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.